to speak at this session, it gives me enormous pleasure to spend the warmest of UK welcomes, seeing as Dr. Victoria Adams has flown in from the States this morning to come and speak to you all. So Victoria's a principal of UK government programmes at Consensus, and as I say, she's flown in from the States to come and chat with us this morning, so please be kind.
US. Can you hear me? Yeah, I didn't know because you can't turn this thing on. It's actually US government programs. So, I just flew in this morning, so I'm in that solar state where my soul is somewhere over the mid-Atlantic. So I'm actually not morally culpable for anything I do right now. So I want to talk to you about three things today. I want to talk to you about Consensus and what Consensus is and how we operate. I want to talk to you about some of the use cases we're doing. And I want to talk to you about some of the potential for blockchain, because I love this technology. This technology has so much promise. We have only barely begun to scratch the surface of how this technology can radically change social organizations, can create new commercial relationships, can develop microeconomies that can really incentivize whole different sets of behaviors. So pumped about technology. Believe it or not, I'm British, but I've spent so long in America, I've got emotional. So, let me tell you about Consensus. Consensus was started by Joe Lubin. Joe Lubin was on the original development team for Ethereum. So we're an Ethereum company. And Joe made a ton of money out of that. And unlike me, who would have spending my time on the beach, Joe decided to create a company that would encourage the use of Ethereum. Probably because he gets a little bit rich if that happens. So, right now, Consensus has about 600 people in about 22 different countries. We're expanding all the time. We consist of five major pillars. The first one is Consensus Solutions, and that's our consulting arm. And we develop bespoke solutions for specific problems. Some of our big clients are Smart Dubai, the government of Singapore. We've done some work with Airbus. We've done some work with Procter & Gamble. We've done some work with Visa. We're doing all over the place, all over the world. The second spoke is we develop the infrastructure and the community around blockchain, around Ethereum. You've probably used some of our products in that sense. Infura, 6 billion downloads a day. CryptoKitties was kicking our ass when it came out. CryptoKitties, anybody? No? Someone needs to still explain that to me. MetaMask, a lot of different infrastructure projects. Then on top of that, we have specific spokes that are products that we're developing. We have 30 plus products right now. Probably the best known of those is Uport, which is a self-sovereign identity system, and Viant, which is a supply chain and process tool. The next one that we do is we have Consensus Academy, which is the leading provider of blockchain training in the world. We do everything from code school up to C-suite. Code school, we really want people to learn this thing. The biggest problem right now with blockchain is developers. The talent base isn't there. So we will train anybody who looks like they have the skills to do it. The system we actually have right now is we charge you for the training, but if you pass, we give you your money back. We really want people to learn this thing, but we want to incentivize them. And then finally, the last pillar that we have is our investment group. We have a $50 million investment fund. That investment fund can invest in token launches. It can invest in new blockchain products. Or we will work with you to get your product rolled out. Now, as a firm that's really committed to blockchain, we run in a decentralized manner, which frankly is a giant pain in the ass when you want to get consensus over something. But it is fantastic. We have different hubs working in multiple different places. using this technology to be able to develop consensus and truth around something. We have developers who are located remotely all over the place. And what we've found is you can run an organization this way. It does work. I want to talk very briefly about some of the work we're doing that bears on transportation. So supply chain is one of the key things. Everybody goes to supply chain first. It's the obvious use case. Right now, we're working with some U.S. ports on the West Coast to start to look at their short haul supply chain and transportation problems. So the issue is drayage, you know, short haul transportation. Things come into the ports. I got to move it a few miles to a warehouse. I have a large community of truckers and independent truckers. Those guys are often not the most trustworthy people in the world. There's a lot of temptation for fraud within that. So we've been working with ports to develop these trust networks, these blockchain-enabled supply chain tracking and process networks, to be able to keep track of who is doing what, where cargoes are going, and then to also use that to pay them, because we can start to incentivize people, either with individual token systems or direct fiat currency. So for instance, we might say, if you consistently are on time, if you consistently manage to move off the port, we can incentivize you with a reward given and a token, which you can cash in for certain benefits related to the port. Another thing we're doing that we're very interested in is the whole infrastructure. One of the challenges that was brought up with the second speaker, Lenny, about the new smart infrastructure that is emerging, is it costs a lot, right? So you've got a lot of government programs that are needed to be able to roll out smart infrastructure, smart intersections, electric charging stations, all of that. What we've been working with is a number of municipalities within the U.S. to do token launches to be able to fund the development of smart infrastructure. So this is something that is off the book, so it's not related to their overall credit rating. And we're able to establish an entity between them and the public that is like a decentralized autonomous agency. We call it a decentralized autonomous government agency, or DAGA, that allows the public to sort of vote up by buying tokens for specific infrastructure they want, and then to be able to use those tokens both to access the technology, access the infrastructure, and as an investment vehicle. So for example, Washington, D.C. had a program to encourage taxi drivers and Uber drivers to shift to electric vehicles, and it offered free charging as an encouragement to do this. Only trouble was, it only put up two charging stations. Those charging stations are over in Southeast. Most of your rides are over in Northwest. So what we're doing now is helping them put together a coin release, a token launch, where drivers and other parties will be able to buy those tokens to be able to fund the development of new charging stations. The token can be used like a municipal bond, having tax relief associated with it. And it can also be burnt, that is used, by the individual drivers who are going to use it. Now, what's the advantage to them? Well, if they buy the token up front, then they get more charges than they otherwise would from that. And secondly, when it comes to municipal bonds, in the U.S., it's very difficult to buy municipal bonds. The average bond is about $5,000. It's gone from being a tool where communities can buy them into something that only rich folks use, and pension funds and all of this kind of thing. The token is cheap. It's about $50. You can buy into it, get as many tokens as you want. We're also trying to encourage environmental groups, electric car manufacturers, other folks to come in. So you'll have it both as a utility token and as an investment token. And we're hoping from that a secondary market will emerge where you can trade that token. That's an example of the kind of behavioral microeconomy that this technology can start. When we start to move away from just thinking about supply chain into how can we use this system to begin to be able to affect behavior. That's a very powerful thing. And as the trust that this thing has, the transparency enables that to go forward. We hope to expand this sort of tokenized infrastructure model to get into much bigger infrastructure, to start to work with cities. We're actually working with a town that has the wonderful name of Peculia, Missouri, to start to do some school bonds on there and other infrastructure using this approach. And the idea is to develop a platform where cities will be able to come into it and then use that token launch thing to fund small infrastructure. We're thinking like under $1 million. You go much above that, you start to get into the bond market. But still, charging station is $60,000 if it's on a roadside. That's something that you need to get a lot of. Finally, we're doing a lot of things in the, I don't know what the name for them is, sort of rich small countries that are emerging, Dubai, Singapore, these places, where, for instance, we with IBM are one of the developers for the Smart Dubai program. And we're developing the payment and trust system that will go on for a whole range of things associated with that technology and with smart transportation projects. I think they have up to 39 smart transportation projects there right now. And those will be coordinated, paid for, tracked using blockchain technology. And that will be a single platform. So we're very interested in that. We're working with Singapore on a similar initiative, and we're also talking to the Philippines about that too. So I think there's a lot of these emerging countries that don't have the legacy systems that we have in the developed world that are able to jump straight in. And when they have the money, they can see some dramatic changes. So we're going to probably be learning from their experience as we go forward. Finally, I'd just like to say, this technology is amazing. We have barely begun to scratch the surface here. Some of the things that are happening with token launches, with data management, are amazing. We're setting up some things now where individuals can begin to trade their own medical data, be able to take your genetic data and be able to sell that and own it, you know, rather than just some government or an insurance company or whatever, taking your data, you will own it, and you will be able to take value from it. We're working, for instance, with the Million Vet operation in the U.S., which is an effort to get veterans to be able to share their data, their health data, their genetic data. This is enabling people to share their data while keeping control of it. So in that case, the vet can share their data to, say, the Veterans Administration, but they won't, say, share it with a pharmaceutical company. So there's tremendous things that are going on. Every week that I talk to somebody, they're coming up with something new. We need to think beyond the typical use cases and really focus on those parts of the process where trust, where decentralization, where whole new ways of conceptualizing incentive systems might be applicable, and think there. Because this technology is going to change the world. This is 1992, and the internet has just started, and someone's told you about it. You know, you're on CompuServe or whatever it was, and there's going to be so much money made out of it. There's also going to be so much social transformation, and we all need to get on board. Because if we get on board, we can avoid the mistakes that we made with the internet. And we can create a system that really does create a decentralized trust system where we can manage assets, where we can manage the basis of our data of ourselves and ensure that we have that frictionless world that this technology promises. Thank you very much.